IVM.
So, guess what? The weirdest possible thing has happened. No. Naren did not get any younger and I have not had a restraining order on my puns yet. But we have a sponsor on the show. We are proud to be sponsored by one of the most legendary tech brands of all time, Intel. So Intel has this new thing called the Intel vPro, that's V-P-R-O. And it's a business platform that ensures your business has the best combination of hardware and software running. Just like we here at Simplified need an ideal combination of jokes and facts running. I mean, it would be terribly sad if we had only one of them. Anyway, Intel vPro maximizes your team productivity and ensures the security of your systems. And that seems like a nice thing to have. For example, if you work on your PC a lot, you will know that there are many frustrating things that could happen, like your boss asking you to work on a new project. Well, we can't do much about that, but we can do something about other things, like helping you open heavy files. Like if you work in media, you deal with heavy files all the time that are gigabytes in size. It takes forever to open and can be really annoying. Also, if you work in media, how do you have the time to listen to a podcast anyway? Never mind. Intel vPro makes sure that you are productive in many ways, and I will return to tell you about those in the coming weeks. But today, I will tell you about the 8th generation vPro processor, which makes a difference to both desktop and mobile platforms. If you want to get your business to be more productive, and who wouldn't, head over to intel.in/vPro, that's V-P-R-O, to learn more. Hi, and welcome to episode 150 of Simplified. Episode
150 plus 3 or something.
150,
no?
50.3. Yeah, something. 150.3, something, like whatever. It's like the sequel that nobody asked for. So I am your host, Chuck, and Srikeit.
I am your host also. Srikeit.
And also, Naren is not here, our other host.
He is victim of rains in Bombay, which are being mirrored here in KL also, in sadness of Naren missing.
Today was, listeners will know that Srikeit is in KL, Kuala Lumpur. So I will update you, Srikeit, with happenings over here in this glorious city. Today was local voting election day.
Of course, yes, I saw many fingers.
You saw... I won't bother to ask you which ones, but it was kind. It was nice because I got in and out of the booth in 30 seconds, but it was also very sad because that meant nobody was there. Part of me was like, yeah, man, I'll vote every week if it's like this. Then another part of me said, no, that's a bad idea. So that was I did my part for Indian democracy by adding my most important contribution to Indian democracy has actually been adding my voting booth on Google Maps. I did during Lok Sabha elections because I couldn't find the damn place, dude. Like, the election website has some cryptic place which is like a pop-up place in one open field. Okay, and obviously it's not listed and nobody knows where to find this damn thing.
Whether you cycled there?
No, I did not. It's not that remote also. Nesco in Goregaon East is not remote enough for me to cycle to. I have standards.
I think the most useful thing that anyone can do is probably make an Instagram booth inside the voting booth. So you can have all the things done at the same time. Cast your vote and like also show your finger and take Insta, whatever selfies and like put it up because that is the most important thing anyway.
Silicon Valley, we hope you are listening. somebody who has been listening are our listeners. What is a collective term that you call them? MBA, right?
An MBA.
An MBA of Simplified listeners.
Can we insult our listeners anymore?
Yes, by saying MBA in communications. No. No.
Oh my God.
So for those of you who actually think that MBA might stand for something else, it really doesn't. It's exactly what it sounds like. The collective term of endearment.
comic series called Mind Your Business Anna or something?
Yeah, this is an old series that I used to do for an MBA website called Pagal Guy, but then that's, I don't think that's any flattering, that's any more, less insulting. Anyway, if you are new to the show, welcome. You have joined us at a very opportune time because we are celebrating the third 150th episode. And what we've done is we have asked our listeners to send in questions and topics that they would like us to simplify. Simplified, the podcast, as you might know, is us attempting to break down things into language that we can understand, which is not a very high bar.
Yeah, I mean, it's not about you at all here. this is an exercise in like adult literacy between three hosts, of which one has left.
Simplified is because the three hosts do not have enough money for beer, so we come to the studio and we talk. That's all.
Yeah, that's true. And then we like...
Then magically we create, one episode.
But we are creating employment for Darius.
Darius is our... long-suffering producer who is wondering whether employment is all cracked up as it's made out to be. Our dear listeners have sent in several questions, and some of them we will simplify. Some of them we've already simplified, and we've had a lot of fun with them on our previous two episodes, which are episode number 150 and episode number 150. You can check them out. We got a ton of really
Dude,
nice...
We make things anymore, it's complicated.
So we've simplified all sorts of things, from why is bubble wrap so satisfying to pop, to the size of the Milky Way, to who has to give you change, is it the conductor, or whose responsibility is it to give you change during a bus journey, is it you or the conductor?
Actually, that's a good place to start, Chuck. We have a couple of updates on the previous episode.
We do?
Some of the questions that were asked there, we can maybe give a few updates, especially with like... So first thing is about the bubble wrap thing.
Yeah.
Listeners might remember there was a Japanese toy that I had talked about called Mugen Puchi Puchi.
And, the clip of you saying that is now my singer. Like, I listen to it on loop before going to sleep. It's very well calming.
Yeah, so Mugen Puchi Puchi is it was particularly hilarious considering I spent much of my last couple of weeks in Japan, literally walking down the streets of Akihabara, which is the nerd town in Tokyo. Asking random people on the street where I can find Mugen Puchi Puchi and getting very, very funny looks from people. Because it's a funny term to say even in Japan. Especially in a quasi-Bangalorean Gujarati South Indian accent. So I actually went to multiple stores and asked for it. So turns out it was like a craze, like Japan moves on from fads like...
Tamagotchi, I remember, virtual pet.
Yeah. Quicker than most things. So that's why, like, quicker than their Shinkansen.
Yeah. One big fad that they moved on in the 1940s was atomic bomb.
Okay, wow. This sudden and unexpected darkness is like quite refreshing, Chuck.
Thanks.
And also fairly chilling considering I did visit Hiroshima. And,
oh, no.
Mugen
Puchi Puchi.
Was that Mugen Puchi Puchi is now no longer available anywhere in Japan. Although I found like a whole variety of very other interesting, many other interesting and weird shit in Japan. Which requires probably an episode by itself. So
that's a great idea. That's a great idea for an episode. Yeah, weird shit in Japan. Yeah, done.
Weird shit in Japan, definitely full. It's like a definite full-length episode.
Full-length episode, I agree.
But anyway, fans of bubble wrap can mourn the loss of Mugen Puchi Puchi to the sands of time because it's not available anymore in Japan. So for another one of our very interesting questions about... whose responsibility it is to provide change, whether it is the bus conductors or yours. We had some very robust discussion in the last episode, and that discussion continued with like great gusto on multiple social channels with people chiming in with their like hilarious plus sob stories.
Bus conductor stories, hashtag.
Bus conductor stories, which was one actually came into Chuck, which was read, "Hello Chuck, daily I have to travel in bus and it costs me 9 plus 9 rupees. Many times I give conductor 10 rupees. He doesn't return 1 rupee. If I ask him, he looks at me like a beggar. So I will be quiet. But next morning, I will only give him 8 rupees. This time, he will be quiet." This works only if you are a regular traveler. There is mutual understanding, you know. I recall this after hearing to part 2 of your podcast. I feel this is one of the best pieces of feedback
I've ever gotten. This is incredible. So thank you to... this was sent to me on Instagram by V Pranamya. Thank you so much for this. I was laughing, dude. Especially that he looks at me like a beggar. So over here, I'm not quite sure whether she's referring to herself as a beggar or...
No, and I like the fact that there is a mutual understanding to be quiet.
Super.
Like, first, I will give money and he won't return change, so he will be quiet.
Just imagine the amount of the mental Excel sheet that he's kept in his head. Huh, this one has given yesterday, this one will, like, this one I owe 1 rupee. Like, wow, dude.
It's like some mating ritual, no? Like one intricate dance.
New respect for conductors. Anyway, Srikeit, I think we should move on because I think we have set a new simplified record for rambling on and on without getting to the topic at hand, and we didn't even have a profundity.
We did 150 episodes while doing this, okay?
Okay. Now that we're done with the updates, thank you. We should do this every time, actually. We should, every time we record an episode, we should look back at all 150 episodes we've done in the past and give updates for all of them. So, I think our first ever episode was on the Greek economic crisis. Second episode was BCCI. So Saurav Ganguly has become never mind. Let's move on.
I think that would cease being navel gazing and just navel diving, I think, at that point.
Navel, get it?
Why? Let's start.
Let's start indeed. Okay. This is a very, very interesting question. This was sent in by Srinidish on Twitter. And Srinidish has been a fan of the podcast for a long time. In fact, I actually bumped into Srinidish at a conference in Goa when I was sitting outside my hotel just reading a book or something. And he came up and are you shocked by any chance? Whoa, okay, how did this happen? And I listened to Simplified. Wow, okay, cool. So major big moment happened for me then. I felt very happy with myself.
Imagine being in Goa and talking about Simplified.
A good segue from that observation, Srikeit, is the question itself. What is the difference? How does weed and alcohol affect your brain differently? So
both of which are plentiful in said place.
But we must state for the record that everything here is academic and nothing here is comes from personal experience.
We have no idea what these substances are. Etc.
Correct. Okay. So let's first start with alcohol. Okay. So this is what alcohol, that vicious, vile liquid. Shame or whatever.
Any new flavors in Dulali, by the way?
Huh? What? I have no idea.
Any new flavors in Dulali?
No. I go to Dulali for the fries. This is Amit Verma claiming to read Playboy for the articles.
Yeah. Very much same.
No. I have no idea what you're talking about. Dulali is a place where I go to for their kombucha. Okay. Alcohol on the brain. Alcohol gets absorbed by the stomach, as we know, and is pumped all over the body, including the nervous system, and it heads to the brain quickly. Over here, it interferes with the nerve cells and the communication between the nerve cells. So things become very sluggy and slow. Now, imagine, listeners, if we didn't rehearse a Simplified episode, how sluggy things would sound. It's that way.
That's pretty normal, right? That's every episode, pretty much. Are you saying we are high all the time?
You said it, not me. These nerve cells. Okay, so these nerve cells which you're talking about, who end up becoming sluggy and slow, they're responsible for a whole bunch of things. And as a result of which, alcohol ends up affecting them. So these include speech, judgment, movement, self-confidence with respect to singing skills, restraint with respect to telling your boss what you think of him, all sorts of things. So nerve cells communicate by sending neurotransmitters between each other. So these nerve cells are basically like, I'm not getting into too much of the science of nerve cells, because that will be an like super long episode by itself. But basically nerve cells communicate with each other, and all this communication at a huge level makes up all the things that go on within your brain. And there are different nerve cells in different parts of your brain that obviously do different things. I'm guessing any average listener of Simplified will know that the brain is not just one big pink sponge, but they're made up of different parts that do different things. Some are responsible for memory, some are responsible for your horny feelings, some are responsible for writing Simplified, some are responsible for listening to Simplified only. There is a part of your brain that has evolved exclusively for listening to Simplified episodes.
Yeah, I know. We will refer to it as the MBA of your brain. But okay. Yeah, I mean, there's also another interesting part about the first case, how alcohol does reach your brain. Because, I mean, if you think about it, technically, most of the stuff that you can eat can get you like messed up in your brain. But most of the stuff that you consume doesn't really reach your brain, because there is this thing called the blood-brain barrier that exists.
Yeah.
Which does not allow for a lot of substances and a lot of stuff in your blood to reach your brain. It goes through a filtration process and then gets to your brain as nutrition. But a few drugs like alcohol and other banned substances, pretty much illicits, they kind of are able to pass through this blood-brain barrier. And because they can pass this pretty high barrier of blood-brain barrier, the brain is a lot more vulnerable because it banks on this barrier, right? Yeah. And which is why it helps do all the funky stuff that Chuck described.
You know, when you said that it passes through the barrier, no, in my mind, I had like Narcos in my head, like you're passing, like bribing the officers at the blood barrier, blood barrier gate, and getting through. Like all the illicit substances, like they're going through. Anyway, so alcohol suppresses something called glutamate, which enhances something called GABA. This GABA is not the ground at birth, but is a little chemical in your head which controls your inhibition. So as a result of all this, what happens is you feel less inhibited, and then you do all the silly things that we spoke about. Experts want
GABA is gamma aminobutyric acid,
correct? Wow, thought that was too much information, but anyway, you can show off the fact that you remember all this.
I remember some random shit from chemistry classes in college, in school. I don't know.
So anyway, experts...
remember anything that mattered clearly, bro.
Yeah. Experts warn that drinking at a young age can damage your brain irreversibly. One, your nerve cells can get permanently damaged as they are still developing, poor things. Just to tell you some parts of the brain and what they do and what potentially alcohol could screw up with. The frontal lobe is responsible for planning, not our type of planning, Srikeit, but general life wala planning, forming ideas, again, not, never mind, making decisions.
Our planning comes squarely from the gluteus maximus.
Which is a part of your brain which broke off from the spine a long time ago in evolution. Planning, forming ideas.
Alternate science.
Yeah. Making decisions and using self-control. All this the frontal lobe is responsible for. Then the cerebellum, which is responsible for coordinating, thinking and being aware. Hippocampus is responsible for memories being made, trouble remembering and having a blackout. And of course, there are several other things, hypothalamus, medulla, all these parts of
your brain. If a hippo camps on you, that blackouts will definitely happen.
Done. Wow. Super. Oh, man.
Just too good. Bad. Too good. Go on. We're all missing Naren right
too good,
now.
Too good, too it also causes a lot of effect on the heart and the liver. And let's not get into that. I read somewhere if it gets into, like I read somewhere on what happens if you have too much alcohol, then somewhere, some scientist somewhere said a hangover is the least of your worries. Okay, so now we'll get into the key part of the question, which is what is the difference between alcohol and weed on your brain? Because a lot of these things, weed also, by weed we of course mean cannabis, which like whatever you call it, ganja or whatever.
Whatever the kids are calling it
these days. The key, so a lot of the things that we just spoke about, which is screwing around with the nerve cells and different parts of your brain, like being inhibited, being, you know, the functions being changed around or whatever it is. A lot of these things weed also does. The primary difference is alcohol has chemicals that are alien to our body, whereas weed has things that are very, very similar to what is in our body.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, weed contains something called cannabinoids, which is similar to a chemical in our brains called anandamide, which Blackstrat Blues fans will know is one of his best songs.
Of course.
Yeah.
I genuinely thought it was something he made up because it had like Anand.
I also thought it was Anand something. Maybe something like that. Doesn't Anand mean happy?
Yeah, it does. Of course it does.
Now we know where Anand comes from. Which may... So the most oxymoronic name then becomes Sadanand because it's sad Anand.
Moving right along.
Srikeit?
I'm right here.
Okay,
hello.
You're right here. Okay, cool. You're right there. Okay, cool. Just testing. Okay, running through this quickly. Neurotransmitters, you know, those things that... Think of neurotransmitters as the messenger between nerve cells. Now, they shut down temporarily after firing or when a task is complete, ostensibly to, you know, recuperate so that they can, the next message they can carry on firing on full cylinders. Cannabinoids like anandamide interrupt this. So what happens is, for example, dopamine is actually a neurotransmitter and it is strongly associated with reward. So when you listen to Simplified, for instance, you have a lot of dopamine swishing about in your brain because, you know, you're doing something rewarding, I suppose. Yeah. So let's say that it stores...
I think the swishing about is happening in a glass in the side.
Okay. So let's say that it stores information about hunger, which is stored in the brain cells in the hypothalamus. Okay. When you feel full, the transformation of this information from one brain cell to the other is stopped. Hence, telling your body, stop eating, you are full. So when you're so, but then cannabinoids like anandamide comes in and they're like, hey bro, it's all good, man. Why bother blocking shit? It's a free world. Let that sweet, sweet dopamine go wherever it wants to go. Go dopamine, you're a free chemical. And in this way, Srikeit, dopamine is like, yeah, I should be going on and telling the other nerve cell also that I'm hungry, even though I am full. I don't know if that made sense, but now you have a nice visual image in your head about what anandamide... Think of anandamide as this hippie guy who is coming and telling all these nerve cells who are feeling a little shy, like, let that dopamine just flow, bro. As a result, you do a lot more things that end up giving you a lot of reward, which is eating more, listening to music and things like that, so that, you know... you feel more rewarded. So that's basically how weed acts on your brain. Now the thing is, anandamide is a chemical that naturally occurs in your brain. All right. And this is controlled to some extent. The brain knows that if there's too much anandamide in the system, then this idiot is going to eat too much and he'll become too fat or he won't do anything. So there is a natural suppression of that. Now, when you smoke or ingest or whatever it is, when you have cannabis, which contains a chemical called THC, which is very similar to anandamide, suddenly what happens is your brain is flooded with something that is very similar to anandamide, as a result of which dopamine flows like crazy. That's basically what happens. Right. So that
Wowza.
Is... Yeah, wowza only it is. It enhances hunger, the other things that happen. So I know we've spoken about hunger, but the other thing that happens when you're high on a drug like weed is enhanced perception. So thoughts and perceptions magnify and you think whatever is happening is the most profound thing ever.
Well, you don't say.
We should...
Must do some clinical trials on this.
Yeah, right? Academic trial. Absolutely, I agree.
Yeah, I mean, to educate our listeners further.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, everything we do is for science.
For science.
Yeah, okay. How does this affect various parts of the brain? Weed affects the cerebellum and something called the basal ganglia, which makes you feel very relaxed. And by relaxed, not just mentally, but also your motor skills also relax. So... it's not as dangerous as driving when drunk, but you're just likely to cause a traffic jam because you're not going to be moving anywhere. So if you do have to do it, don't drive. Neocortex and hippocampus, which are responsible for executive function and thinking, obviously gets amplified and all that. Nucleus accumbens is the reward center, hence food. Amygdala, emotions and anxiety. And for some people, this is a huge problem when they have... when they have drugs like this, sometimes they feel extremely, extremely anxious and paranoid. And you have your amygdala to thank or blame for that. And the jury is still out on whether whether kids should have cannabis. Largely, it's thought of as a bad idea because the brains are still developing and you can really screw around with them. So if you do have to do drugs, please wait till you are of... I suppose voting age, which I think is a good time to start. Anyway,
it's like it's a poignant day to state this. Yeah. Especially since Maharashtra has got to vote today.
Anyway, it's a dry day also. Okay, so Srinidish, yeah. Thank you very much for your question. Clearly, all this was very, very academic research. So we have no, we are only reading what other
erudite. Erudite and anandimide people have written.
Yeah. So TLDR, both weed and alcohol, get through the security of your security gate of your brain. Go in and screw things around in various ways. Alcohol generally makes you less inhibited and hence more likely to do stupid things. Weed, on the other hand, boosts the reward center of your brain so that you end up doing things like eating and... listening to music and stuff like that a lot more, whereas reducing your motor skills, so you're more likely to be sitting on your beanbag, listening to Porcupine Tree, eating Zatar Naan from Carter's Blue. Oop, that became a little too real all of a sudden. Let us take a quick break and we'll see you on the other side of this break.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I also kind of wanted to make a couple of other announcements, right? So first, as I think I mentioned last week, I just want to kind of reiterate, we're going to be closing our SoundCloud channel at the end of this month. So if this is where you're hearing us, please maybe try and listen to us on something else, maybe the IBM Podcast app, maybe another app. We're on all kinds of different platforms. The other thing is a little happier, right? So for the first time ever in Asia, we have a podcasting award for shows made in Asia. And we're very happy to announce that a number of our shows have been nominated. Pesa Vesa, Tech Careers in the New, Vartal Lab and Junior One have all been nominated for these awards. Please go to the website asianpodcastawards.com and go vote for our shows. Come on, make us win, guys. On Cyrus Says This Week, check out the episode we did with The Cast of the Upstarts, the new Netflix series. On the Empowering series, Zarina is joined by stand-up comedian Shrija Chaturvedi. On this episode, Shrija talks about her journey as a stand-up comedian, the way she perceives her struggles, and what makes her feel the most empowered. You thought Simplified were done with celebrating their 150th episode? Not even close. Chuck, Naren, and Srikeit are back with the third part of their 150th episode. Make sure to tune in to see if your questions are featured. On GabyCD, Farhad and Sunetru talk about the evolution through college life and their experiences that changed them forever. This week on Boundless, Natasha reads the poem calling out all aunties who pressurize us to be a certain way and shares her idea of a charming prince. On Golgappa, host Tripti is joined by actor and contestant on Big Boss Marathi, Neha Shitole. She talks about her experience in the Big Boss house and the politics in it. On Feeding 10 Billion, Ramya and Varun talk to food historian Kurush Dalal. They delve into the history of our food and how it dictates our future. On Agla Station Adulthood, Ayushi and Ritasha talk about celebrating girlhood on Girl Child Day. Together, they talk about the situation of women and girls in the country and how important it is for them to have powerful role models, a sense of freedom, and the ability to exercise agency. On The Habit Coach, Ashton talks about daydreaming and how one must engineer their imagination. With that, let's get you onto your show.
So, welcome back to Simplified. Or Simplified 150.3 X... X plus Gamma. N if N is infinity or something like that. So we are currently in the process of simplifying multiple requests that our listeners have sent in of shit that they were too lazy to Google.
We do a value added service to this, dude. Anyone can like Google and all. No?
We Google inaccurately. That should be a new tagline.
No, see, the expertise is already there on WebMD. Why do people go to a doctor? Similarly, we are there, like, I don't know, like curiosity doctors.
Yes. Yeah, I know. I mean, we are like the I'm feeling lucky button on Google. Like, kuch bhi mil sakta hai.
What are we simplifying next? And who has
so we will be simplifying next. And the next topic is also by Srinidish.
Oh, happy birthday, Srinidish. I guess.
Yeah, I know. This is like Srinidish's episode.
Yeah.
So he sent in some very quality topics to simplify. Hey,
by the way, for everybody else who's listening, we have got others. It's not like we paid like 5 people to send 10 questions each or something. We have like.
It's particularly hilarious, Chuck, that you have suggested that we have paid anybody to do anything here at this point. But considering our own financial statuses. Hi, Amit Doshi. So, yes. So, Srinidesh has sent in another interesting question, which, he's phrased it fairly simply, but it can be looked in multiple ways. Mm-hmm. One is about, very, very, very simply says, space travel, why is it a big deal?
Mm.
Right. Mm. So now, while looking this topic up, I kind of looked at it in two different ways. All right. One is, why is space, so space travel can also be looked at as space exploration, right?
Right.
So why is space exploration itself a big deal? Why should we explore space?
Oh, now right? Full, what is the like whole when point? People are in poverty, why send rockets into space?
So yeah, that the classic argument that people are dying of hunger in Ghatkopar. I don't know why I suddenly picked on Ghatkopar, but you Ghatkopar.
Wow, the Malad rivalry is really showing now.
Yeah, I know. But anyway, so when people are starving, why are people being sent to space? But if we were to look at that particular argument, there's actually quite a solid, when I was researching, I thought there will be like some op-ed piece written by some NASA scientist on this. But actually, there's pretty solid like evidence and a very, very solid chain of what is called space spin-offs. Of technology that has actually helped like common life from what has been developed for space exploration. So first and foremost, so there are multiple dimensions of why space exploration is important. First and foremost, let's take the core of why space exploration is done in the first place, not just any like happy accidents or happy spin-offs that come from it. Space exploration is done from the sole purpose of enhancing our knowledge of space.
Right.
Right. Now, when you're trying to enhance your knowledge of space. I mean, you're like, okay, there is the moon in the sky. I found out from calculations on Earth that it does all of these things and it causes waves and like is important for Ganesh Chaturthi in some way. But other than that, like, why should I bother to go to go to the moon or bother if it has water or bother with anything at all? Especially back in 1969 when come on, we had better things to do, like this, like the Cold War and like...
And the thing we spoke about before the break.
Yeah. And sorry. And of course, definitely, which was the rage at that time.
Which so, is a rave also at that time.
Yeah, pretty much. So, with the whole idea of enhancing your knowledge of space, what it did was it has created what exploring space at that point does is that it creates this base of information that is that kind of becomes relevant as time goes on. So while there was exploration of space and while there was finding out about the moon that started in 1969, it set the base for understanding the different areas of the moon, which set the base for different exploration missions from around the world to go there, which has set the base for understanding that there is water on the moon, which Chandrayaan discovered, which is now eventually set the base in this context of global warming that we may even potentially colonize the moon.
It's a slow burn, basically.
It's a slow burn. So in 1969, there was no conception of global warming or climate change or anything that suggested the Earth would become uninhabitable.
Yeah.
But the work that was done there was what set the foundation for this possibility to even arise today. So fundamentally, the first use is that we may not know what the applications will be in the future of the research that we do today.
Fair enough.
Right. So that's the first very basic port of call. But again, that is still quite theoretical. And you're like, it's still like, okay, but people are starving today.
Yeah.
So if you were to take that simple argument and go by it, there is a thing called, there's actually a program called NASA spin-offs. Now they do a publication where they literally publish on a monthly basis the different types of technologies that NASA has developed in the process of developing like space shuttles and all the technology that they develop and how it's been applied into everyday life. So these NASA spin-off technologies literally go across multiple different areas, like for example the most important being applications in health and medicine.
Yeah.
And here, in fact, we don't even need to look at a NASA example. The ISRO and the DRDO, in fact, have developed technologies. This is something, in fact, funnily enough, I remember studying sometime in school, where our beloved late President APJ Abdul Kalam, who had at one point in time gone to a hospital and was and had seen some of the kids who were suffering from polio at the time wearing calipers, which were these braces, leg braces on their legs, which weighed 3 kilos. Now, the children themselves were about 10, 15 kilos heavy, and they were dragging along these really heavy braces. And Abdul Kalam felt really sad about it. And he at the time was working with some really super light carbon heat shields for the Agni missile, in fact. So, he decided to put some engineers from the DRDO along with some doctors and developed like new calipers that the children could wear, which weighed 300 grams instead of 3 kilograms. Oh. So suddenly, like, and this technology is used to this day. I mean, this is DRDO developed technology. So there's super light carbon fiber calipers. There was another thing that was developed, which was a pacemaker, developed again from actually missile technology more than even space technology. So there's quite a few even Indian examples on this. But of course, there's also so some of the interesting technologies that have come out from NASA spin-offs are, for example, LASIK. LASIK was actually developed So LASIK was it came from this imaging technology called LADAR, which was used in military and NASA sponsored research. And then afterwards, LASIK technology was developed from that for ophthalmologists to correct vision and stuff like that. Yeah. So that is developed from NASA technology.
Even Nike shoes, I think. Sneakers in general.
Yeah. So even the material that they use, especially the foaming and all that stuff, was developed from there.
Like LASIK and laces. Sorry.
Too much.
I provided my own laugh track also.
So even things that you would not really think about, like for example, enriched baby food, it was developed because of research into space food. Actually helped develop, understand how nutrition can be compacted better, and therefore helped in developing a lot of enriched baby food as well.
Very cool.
This was also another very interesting, of course, solar cells. So solar cells, which are now being extensively used to generate electricity. The first solar cells were, of course, used in space technology and in space. So now that technology is being transferred to the Earth and how we can use these things here. And of course, GPS, the GPS signal in its very first case was created for guiding satellites. But eventually, of course, now it's one of the most ubiquitously used satellite technologies around the world.
So basically, if there were no NASA and space, basically, there would be no Google Maps, there would be no Uber, there would be no
Google Maps. And now actually, if you look at it this way, while initially space, all the space travel and space exploration, any kind of stuff that went into space was for space exploration. But now a whole bunch of technology that was developed for space exploration is actually used for detecting stuff on Earth. So, for example, remote sensing, weather detection, you're trying to detect where the next tsunami and the next hurricane, where they are heading. You're trying to detect where water is and what is the water crop patterns. All of these things are now being detected from space, and especially stuff like GPS. So multiple technologies of your everyday life, from everything on your smartphone to like your weather systems and all of that stuff, is now developed because of space exploration. Wow. So
literally everything on your smartphone, because I think the screen for a smartphone, I think the technology for that was first again used for spacecrafts or something.
Exactly. Yeah. So I mean, so therefore, the next time anyone asks you what space exploration is good for, please don't just resort to that stupid Three Idiots joke about the pencil and the pen. which is one of the most done to death and forwards that was sent around in the 90s. Which that movie, by the way, is entirely developed out of forwards sent in the 90s. So please, like, understand there is a lot more to what space exploration
and
has
there
done.
Are a lot better 90s forwards, actually, if you want
Oh my god, please read one of the Zimbabwe inflation forwards. They were a lot funnier. So I mean, that's one other part, that's one part of why space exploration is important. So the other part that can be inferred from Sri Indish's question about space travel, what's the big deal, is just you could infer it as, what is the big deal about traveling in space? I mean, how does jet propulsion in space work and those things? And that is a whole big topic by itself.
I think another big unsaid benefit of space travel is, I think it's especially when you do literally moonshot things like going to the moon, it becomes such big news that it actually just inspires a whole generation of people to take up science, read, become curious and things, especially in this day and age.
That was a very important point. Actually, that's what I was reading an article about this, where they were saying that in 1961, when JFK actually said that we will put a man on the moon by the end of the decade, the US was actually considered technologically a very backward country at that time. And when they actually did put the man on the moon was when the technology boom actually took place following decades in the US. So the whole idea that it really inspired the nation, so to speak, to feel that they were, I mean, it was almost like a spark to the superiority of the US, where they felt that, you know, we are the first people to go onto the moon. We are therefore the most technologically advanced, and that removed the shackles of their industry and followed were the golden decades of the US technology and cultural superiority era. Followed by a couple of decades later came Trump, and the rest is history.
It's just like how when we started Simplified, we inspired a whole generation of podcasters.
People asking questions without Googling.
Have we made people lazy? Like how Google apparently has made people forget how to calculate and spell. Do you think we will reach a stage where, because of Simplified, I don't know this, I'll just like ask the Simplified guys?
I just feel it's very much like a performing monkey. It's like Natch.
Nice.
So people are just like, huh, yeah, why not? Press button, monkey. So I think it's kind of that place rather than like us replacing Google.
Put three monkeys in front of a mic and eventually they'll podcast out the entire works of Shakespeare. Something like that, no?
Or at least a fairly mediocre, inaccurate podcast.
Okay.
So yeah, that was why space travel is such a big deal, Sri Nidish. From Twitter, and thank you for your question, and send no more, because we have answered all the shit that you have sent me. We have dedicated a whole friggin' episode to you, so stop it now.
Okay, so taking off from the first question, because when you consume, apparently I am told, when you consume cannabis, your head gets spacey, hence space travel. The other thing that happens, you end up eating a lot, which now segues me into the next question, which is apparently about waist sizes. And this has been asked to us, Srikeit, by...
What a long freaking segue, Chuck.
I took the scenic route.
I would say this topic is relevant because you're such a waist fellow.
Thanks. So along with asking asking our listeners for questions, we also asked some of the IVM podcast hosts to send us questions. And this comes in from Mikhail from the Wadaplaya podcast.
Wadaplaya.
Hello, I am Mikhail, the host of Wadaplaya, and I have a very deep question. Why is it that waist sizes numbers are less than the actual length of the tape around my waist? Because I was very disappointed when I found out that I'm wearing size 32 jeans, but my waist is not 32. So can you simplify that for me?
That's an interesting question, Srikeit, especially for people who are trying to watch their waists. Uh-huh. For me, waist size number is different from waist size, which is different from what the tape measure also says.
Yeah, and what the scale says every morning.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, and the scale. I just go with the lowest number. Ego is more important than health. Anyway, okay.
Or put like really low batteries inside.
Okay. So what tends to happen is typically your waist size, your actual waist size tends to be bigger than the size of the clothes that you buy. So you may be a size 34, but the clothes that you buy might be a size 32. Any guesses, Srikeet, as to why this is?
Objects in mirror are bigger than they appear.
Eh? No, no. What?
I don't know. That
this is an answer. I thought you'd get this easily. This is something called vanity sizing. Clothing manufacturers basically want you to feel good about your size, regardless of the reality.
Wow, excellent.
Yeah. So
no, this actually feels relevant because there was a product I was watching on Shark Tank, which was called the Vanity Mirror,
It's a rubbish product. Sorry.
Yeah, so that thing, she actually got really like badly shot down by all the sharks
because
they called her product unethical, but what her mirror effectively did was made you look thinner than you actually are.
Yeah. So I don't know how that's going to help. Imagine going to your oncologist with a cancer ka x-ray or whatever, and he's like, no, look at this x-ray. See, you have no tumor. You are okay.
Yeah, I know. That's amazing. No, but it's actually a pretty nefarious way of getting people to buy products, because if you feel thinner than you are, you'll end up buying shit that you will like.
That's exactly what vanity sizing is. So manufacturers are actually they do so size 36 gets adjusted to size 34, etc., etc., so that people feel, oh, okay, cool. Now I can buy more. And this is becoming more pronounced in the last few decades because, well, let's face it, people around the world, especially in the so-called developed nations, first world countries, if you want to refer the first episode of the 150th episode series.
This is the first question we answered, right?
First ever question. It'll remain, it'll always have a place in our 150th episode hearts. Series is going to end. We might end like this. If we do 49 more episodes like this, then our direct 200th episode, where we'll do the same stunt again.
Yeah, I know. For
Simplified is basically going to become a glorified talk show.
It's like when the train starts leaving from Borivali and like suddenly before you know it, you're in Vasai.
Okay, listen. Americans especially have grown physically larger over the last few years. So brands have shifted their metrics to make shoppers feel skinnier, so much so that a woman's size 12 in 1958 is now a size 6.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, this is according to Time. I quote directly from them. A pair of 16-inch waist suit trousers at Marks & Spencer were at least 37.5-inch wide when checked with a measuring tape. So basically what you're saying is a 36-inch pant that you buy is actually not like 36 inches. It's much more. And so the problem with this is that it's all unstandardized, right? Different brands use different things differently, which is why you never know whether the size 34 that you buy is actually going to fit you or not. So whether, you have a, look at the like range it could go from, like anywhere from 32 all the way up to 38 or something.
This is particularly troublesome in case of shoes, actually.
Yeah.
Whenever I go to a shoe store and she asks me, like, what size are you? And, like, I say, like, I'll say a 9. And then she'll suddenly say UK or US. And then I'm lost. I'm like, dude, I have no idea. Just measure my foot and put a shoe on it. I have no freaking clue what size I am. And the same thing. Like you go to a store and then they have UK sizes, US sizes, and then some size, which is some like size, some unstandardized, like humne abhi napa hai, darji piche baitha hai.
Like I remember, like once when I was at a gig and I was buying a t-shirt for myself, I asked my wife Divya whether she wanted one. I asked her what a size was, and then she gave me, said, if you're buying a men's by this size, if you're buying a women's by this size, like, wow, what? Like,
yeah, that's the same thing. I mean, I think wives have this down to a science. Like, I genuinely now only bank on, like, my wife Ishani's knowledge on what clothes I should wear, because I have no freaking clue at this point. I've lost track now.
No. We were talking about vanity sizing, not our own failure with respect to the sartorial skills. We will continue.
We got success in context of wives.
Yeah. Esquire, no, the magazine, they even took, they actually did a entire study, as they took all the popular brands and looked at who deviates the most.
And
the winner was Old Navy, where they found discrepancies of up to 5 inches. But in a way, I feel that this has one good effect, Srikeit. I think that brick and mortar stores are still going to be around. Because I think twice, if you do this stunt with e-commerce companies and you feel so frustrated at having to return and all that shit, you're eventually, I'm just going to go to a store and freaking try this thing on.
Yeah, I mean, that's one where at least brick and mortar companies have it good. I mean, they still online... trying of different clothes and fit and this thing has not become a reality yet. Waiting for haptic suits that will help us do that in the future.
That's how we are going to end this episode. We started with weed versus alcohol on your brain, then we went into space travel, and then we came crashing down to earth with waste sizes. Yes. So thank you, Srinidish and Mikhail, for sending in those questions. One of you is barred from sending in questions for a while. Actually, no.
Yes.
We will be back next week with another 150th episode. There's going to be at least one more after that. That one will be an almost Naren exclusive because he couldn't make it today. And that's about it. Srikeit, any parting words from Michu Pichu?
Mugen Puchi Puchi. I wonder how many times you're going to make me say this on this show now. But as Naren would say, stay safe. Stay. Which one of our topics do we pick over here?
Unindimited.
Stay wasted. Stay wasted.
Yeah.
It at least brings two of the two topics together.
Stay
wasted and stay simplified.
Yeah, that makes sense, I think.
Hi guys, this is Ayushi.
And I am Ritasha.
And welcome to Agla Station Adulthood.
It's a fun podcast we've got going on and we'd love for you to tune in and enjoy with us.
Join us as we stop at various stations and discuss different topics that seem to be bothering us and hopefully
dating,
you as well.
Relationships, beauty, just being an adult, lots of different things.
We don't have a great grip on it, but we've done okay so far.
Catch Agla Station Adulthood every Thursday on the IVM app, the IVM website, or wherever else you get your podcasts.
Hello everyone, welcome to Tech Careers in the New, the new podcast series presented by Accenture, and I'm your host, Shiladitya Mukhopadhyay. In this podcast series, we'll get you the latest and greatest in the world of technology that's shaping the future of business as we know it. We're talking intelligent platforms, cloud, AI, blockchain, extended reality, and a whole lot more. Every fortnight on Wednesdays, we'll have for you a hot topic with expert speakers from Accenture, talking about top trends in the space, how these are changing the world and creating growth across industries. And more importantly, we'll tell you how you can learn more, build your skills and expertise to grow and stay relevant in your career. Episodes out on the IVM Podcast app or wherever you get your podcasts from.